do they chase them for 6 months? Or do they just leave it 13 years and then go, by the way, will the council haven't done it, they've got to get, send them a letter? Or is it one of those things where...
Sure, no, yes.
I'm not speaking to officers, what Jeff was saying, I think what you've alluded to as well, but it's more of a political thing, in that it just keeps getting back into the long grass on the basis that, oh, we'll do it next week, or we'll make a decision on that later, and it goes into the bottom of a pile, and it's going to get finished, and it's a movable feast, isn't it?
It is, I mean, that's a very interesting question, I think, from this perspective, because all the way through the plan-making process, we have had regular discussions with DLCG officials, and they know exactly where we're up to. They also know where we're up to with all of those things that I mentioned before, like the neighbourhood plans, the city region work, the duty to cooperate, and so on. And whilst, you know, we've been making the progress that we have, we've been fully aware of that. We have not met some of those timescales before, you know, that is clear. But we've still been working alongside the DLCG all the way to say this is where we're up to and so on. And that. And then this letter came out of the blue. In that, about half an hour or less before the minister stood up on his feet, we received a phone call to say that we would be named in this speech that he was about to make. So we were taken aback at that, given that we had no prior warning or notification, or there was no, you know, how things sometimes in life, people lead up to things by saying, look, you know, you're not performed here, you need to get better, if not, then we'll do this, and you gradually do it instead. This just came out in the way that I've just described, and surprised us, given that we've been sharing all this information with them. The only other observation I would make, and just repeat this if I can, just for the benefit of Councillor Green, who wasn't here at the beginning, just so you've got the information, because it's relevant to what you said. In terms of the letter and our observation on it, it's couched very much in terms of housing growth, and that seems to be the main motivator behind this. Now, we know that that's
a budget strategy as well, isn't it?
Yeah, well, we know that that's a key we know that that's a key plank of the government's policy, and it's also a key priority for ourselves as a council. That's the stated views of the administration. But I think there is a link here between, obviously, the government want to see more houses built generally than nationally, you know, and now this focus on the local plan, and maybe why it was mentioned and it came out in the way it was. But that's the only observation I can offer.
If I could just ask then, will the local, will central government then be asking for a definitive reason for the lack of the report being done, the plan being done? Because it has to be a definitive reason, doesn't it? We haven't done it because... Because technically it's always been possible to do it. The only reason for it not to have been done is that you and both Jeff have alluded to, is it for political reasons?
Well, we've been asked in the letter by the Secretary of State to outline any exceptional circumstances which, in the view of the Council, justify, as he puts it in his letter, the failure of your Council to produce a work plan.
You don't have to be exceptional circumstances that are exceptional to the Borough Council definitively, as opposed to other councils who have done the plan, because we're all working on the same framework, don't we?
Yeah, I think, and again, I haven't got the benefit yet of the civil servants information on that, but I think as things are shaping up at the moment, our response as a council, my suggestion would be one, to you know, draw the Secretary of State's attention to the observations that I made earlier on about the letter, so about the neighbourhood plan and the duty to cooperate and all the things that we have done and are doing, and how all those things are are functioning, you know, in terms of that, because I think he needs to just understand, as I'm sure he will do, that this is our position. You know, he's got to see the real picture. And then, obviously, the exceptional circumstances will be still things that, once I've got greater clarity from his department on why and what he is looking for on that, then we'll have to see how we respond to that. But that will have to come, I think, in a few weeks' time. I just don't have that information at the moment.
And so will it be Phil Davis that writes the letter to give the definitive reason for the lack of progress?
Yes.
The exceptional circumstance.
The letter was addressed to the leader of the council, and in my conversations with him, he will respond to the Secretary of State.
And will we get a copy of that letter?
I don't know. I assume that will be a public letter, and it will be available and shared then, yes.
I'm going to bring in Tony Smith and Tony Jones. Chris and I have indicated that we want to come in again, but you may have agreed because you've already spoken. So Tony Smith?
Yeah, I mean, it really is a follow-up from what Cassie was saying. I mean, I was going to talk about exceptional circumstances, wondering what exactly we would be saying to the Secretary of State. But I'm sort of struggling here. We've made progress in a lot of areas, is what you're saying, David. But it seems the Secretary of State is saying we've got to have a local plan. That seems to be what, and you know, finding it hard to get around in my mind exactly why we haven't managed to do that. But you know, I think you've tried to explain it. Armido, what is the difference between a local development scheme and a local plan? You keep talking about local development scheme, and we've done all this in regard to, you know, sort of, you know, could you not put that plan with all the work that's been done over the last 13 years or 10 years or whatever? Could you not put that plan together fairly quickly and send it to the Secretary of State? Now, it mightn't be good enough, but at least he could respond to it and say, well, you know, you need to improve our civil servants, but improve it in these particular areas.
answer Smith's questions, we could do that, but we know now that if we did a plan like that and sent it to him, he would send it back saying that the plan, this is a technical word, is not sound. The critical features of our plan making now essentially come down to housing need, what it is, where it is in Rural, and then where are we going to meet that housing need in terms of land supply to build those homes. So at the moment, in the government's latest consultation paper, Wirral has been given a figure of 803 residential units per annum the next 15 years that we need to build to meet our objectively assessed need. That doesn't include any percentages that you put onto that for growth within the local economy. Okay, so we're just working on objectively assessed need, 803. Over the past few years, on average, we have been building in Wirral about 500 units a year. It fluctuates a little bit, but it's about 500. So you can see that we have to move from the 500 to the 803 just to meet objectively assessed need. And it's a requirement of the local plan that when we submit that, we say this is our need and this is where we're going to provide for it. And that needs to be shown by land allocations on which you could build housing. Now, our current challenge as a council is that when you look in our existing urban areas at all the residential allocated land, and you add that up, and you add to that all of the employment sites for which there is now no employment land, and you add any other brownfield and any other land together, and you could work out the number of units that those sites would occupy.
And already agreed permissions.
And already agreed permissions, yes, and all of those things. And also, when we look at maximising density of development to make sure that we're getting the maximum use of the land. When you do all of that calculation and you work it all through, we are short of housing allocated land. And so then what the council has got to consider is, okay, how do we find that additional land that we need to meet our objectively assessed need? And that's where you then have to review all of your land development options, which includes the Greenbelt as part of that. And so the position we're at the moment is the administration has wanted to consult on those land development options. So we've been doing pieces of work over the past few months. The latest one is the Greenbelt review methodology to actually say, okay, how would we address that particular issue? And the current plan is that, because there's more work to do, we're waiting for things like the shelter report at city region level and other things. There's pieces of work to do as we go into 2018, and we've got a series of dates where we'll be reporting back on various things. But the key date for pulling all of that information together about the housing and the land and those matters are going to be around June, July next year, because we can't really do that more quickly than we can now do from where we are today from that. So that is what we're trying to do. So really, there's no point doing the plan and putting it in, because we know it's going to get rejected, because the rules of plan making are very clear in that regard. And so what we have proposed to do is meet the timeline that's set out in this report, which, as I say, is it has been agreed, and it's the administration's timeline for moving that local plan through the next phases. Now,
Chair, just very quick on that. Very good. So all the other local authorities who've drawn up a local plan have got their housing and land needs sorted out. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, they will, because the things are that the housing need, it's just a technical calculation. It's a bit complicated, but you know, you can do that as a technical piece of work. The only thing that's...
Sorry, Derek, can I just be clear? Yeah. That's something we as Wirral officers oversaw during that technical need, yeah. The needs analysis. Yeah. It wasn't something that suddenly got imposed by the government. It was us doing that technical...
Your answer in short is yes. Those councils that have done have taken the housing need into consideration.
Yes, but could I just clarify, just for members' benefit? Sorry, Chair, this is important, though. There are different methodologies to work out housing need, but we applied a methodology, and it's a technical report. What's happened just recently, as you'll be aware, is the government has come out with a consultation paper on objectively assessed need and the methodology for calculating that. And so that consultation hasn't yet reported, so we don't know if there's going to be a change in any of that methodology. From what we can see in the in the consultation paper and the way that we've done it, is there isn't a great deal of difference. But again, you know, these things keep coming out and changing around that.
But again, just for clarity, Chair, we're saying this, we as Wirral chose the methodology, we as Wirral determined what the housing need was, and then we as Wirral then have to identify the land that will meet the housing need that we have identified.
That is correct, yeah.
Am I just a technical question, Chair? Just to clarify, I'm not quite sure I heard it right before. DCLG have appointed a contact for our officers to have dealings with in relationship to the letter. But they actually sent a wrong email address for that contact. Did I actually hear that correct?
I think they sent it to the wrong email address.
Yeah. What, they've done is they sent an email to the council's chief executive, but they got his email wrong because they missed, I think it was either an R and L out of Wirral, so we didn't get it until yesterday.
So well, how did you know to look for it then?
Because they sent another one.
I got it right this time. The correct email address.
Yes.
Well, once
just following off what Councillor Muspratt asked for, which was a list of what changes were made and why it was held up, I'd like to ask if it's possible, because we've been talking about this being affected a lot by political issues and political changes and blah blah. I'd just like to add, if we can add to that list the reasons why they were postponed, changed or removed, and what the political issues were, I'd like to see what politically would enable you to miss from 2007, because it's supposed to be finished now, and now we're talking about another 3 years, so is that possible, David, to put on that list? What it was that moved things so far?
It's all administrations, all of us.
Yeah.
We can cast blame where we like, but it's all of us.
It's not a question of, I just want to find out what we're doing.
Well, we're talking about 13 years. We're talking about 13 years of what appears to be non-action by us all, and going back on things by us all, and politically. I think we need to see where.
Yes.
What I can do for you is I can set out the process that we've been through and the key decision points and where those decisions have been taken and the reasons for that. That will be obviously a fairly detailed piece of work because we're going from the beginning to where we are today. But I think I can set the facts of that journey out for you. Clearly I can't comment on any in political, but I can set it all out for you.
It's as a result of various administrations and their change of plan, and then say I can't say anything political because the remark itself is political. I feel quite uncomfortable with this because we're all to blame and we all have to accept that they probably never.
I think the point that my understanding, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but the political decisions will not be discussed with the officers, so we wouldn't be able to comment. So if a political decision to delay a plan was a political decision, that would be made by the political party, and the officers will just be instructed. So he wouldn't be able to comment.
Well then, can I just say, how would you know what the reason was if you were instructed to do something? Unless you were aware, you can't say that was the reason. You can say it was delayed, but you can't say for what reason.
Yeah, but I think what David has said is that it's different administrations.
If we're talking about sharing our blame, Labour and Conservatives before 2015, whoever was in charge, seemed to be doing okay. It's since then that the times have slipped. It's right up to December 2014, we were okay. And then by July 2015, that's when the data started missing. It wasn't due by now, it was due by last year on the original plan, December 2016. So there is only one administration since the times have started slipping. We were actually on track till then. So just to clarify that, and just one point, this is another issue because you did mention the housing needs. When you say that we need to build 800 houses a year, does that include the fact that we've got 6,000 empty properties, we've got 13,000 planning permissions that haven't been built, 13,000 planning permissions across the world, like 800 houses a year, 16 years, that touches the green belt.
That's what we need.
Yeah. So, okay. I know that's a different issue, but the first point, just to clarify the timescale.
The second point is very relevant.
Yes,
12,045 houses we need over 15 years. Correct. We've got 13,000.
I'll try and answer the first part of the question. In that, I mean, what we can do for you is we can put down the facts on what happened between 2012-14 and just give you a chronology of it, the key events.
Don't need to whisper 2012-14.
No, you need to know what happened from the beginning of this. That's what I'd like David to show us that.
Doesn't really. We've got, obviously, the full history going back to 2004.
Yes,
so if it's helpful to members, yes, and you want us to set out, if you like, the chronology of the story, yeah, we can do that, yeah, and then you can see all of those key things.
When David's talking before, talking about the method, the methodology changed, does that mean that all of the councils who've done their plan before the methodology changed will now have to resubmit a new one using new methodology? And had we done our plan before the methodology changed, would we have then been okay, or would we have to redo it anyway?
Yes.
The fact that all councils, bar 13, had submitted their plan, will they all have to submit another one now? And the 13 that haven't still have to submit one, but with new methodology?
No, the way I understand it is that once you've got your plan in place, that is your plan, and that's your statutory frame. You may need
so, sorry, I'll just put in there. So in 2015, when we were on track, why didn't we at that point in time say, right, go, that's it, done? Because the fact that for 2015 it wasn't sent, the time frame is gone since then, is we're in a position where we're getting a letter from central office.
And the reason, sort of headline terms, but without going into detail, because again, we get into the chronology, it would be then the issues that came in about the housing need and the housing land allocations. And those obviously are key issues, and obviously all of that work that was done and various decisions were taken at that time.
Bunch of strategy stuff as well.
So that's why we are where we are.
So we're off the ball. I'm not saying that you were, but somebody somewhere was.
The way I would put it is, whenever you're considering any issue, you have a range of options and approaches normally to it. And depending on which perspective you're coming from, and what you're looking at and where you're trying to get to, you will make decisions informed by that. And here, this is a plan-making process within the council. It's a council plan, and decisions will be taken, and views will be taken on things as it progresses.
But presumably the administration in 2015 made the wrong decision at the wrong time.
Can I make another observation? And I think it's around how the council works, because David said that it's a council decision. So without wishing to get too dull, as I understand it, this is a plan that has to be endorsed by the entire council. Yeah, so the 66 others. But the way we operate is we operate, despite it being a council-wide decision, the council only gets to view it and to discuss it and to make a decision on it once it's been reported to the cabinet. So it's a council decision, It ends up going to the Cabinet. The Cabinet take a view and recommend to Council what it should do. And that, one presumes, will mean, unbeknownst to us, or all of us anyway, there might be things going backwards and forwards because it has to come to Cabinet first. Surely, if we were using our scrutiny committees effectively, wouldn't that discussion of the development of that plan have been carried out here? Wouldn't it have been something where all members would have had a view and had an opportunity before it ended up going to full council, for full council to take a view? And maybe, Paul, in whatever we go back to, comes out of this, going back to cabinet and so on, that we start saying that if these are council side decisions, then scrutiny committees should be, members should be involved in that, rather than officers and cabinet going backwards and forwards before it comes to the full council. Because that to me, because as we know, cabinet is one party, whereas these scrutiny committees are at least balanced and you have that wide range of view. And it seems to me that how we run our processes within the council seems to be partially responsible for some of this too.
Can I just say that we have raised this. Councillor Gilchrist has raised the lack of local plan. We've raised the lack of local plan. You've raised the lack of local plan. And we've always been given answers that we were all okay. I've written it down two or three times. That, and I know Councillor Gilchrist has raised it in committees I've been on a regular basis. But what's difficult is, when you look at something in 2012, and it doesn't reappear. We're not robots. No. We can't remember everything. We do have a colleague up here who's good at remembering those things. But we certainly have discussed the fact that we haven't had the local plan. All of us.
And just to add to that, and then welcome to recommendations, please, is that since I've been elected, it was one of the first things I remember it being discussed, a lack of a local plan, but it was in the process. And that's still continuing to turn out, and we don't seem to have got any further forward with it, despite the concerns that have been raised. And obviously, prior to me being elected, it was clear to go, and it's evidence. Okay, the recommendation for the report.
Could I ask, since I'm a visitor of the committee, and the solicitors may say whether I'm allowed to say anything that's not at committee's discretion, and that's not being made, could I make a brief query?
don't fall for it.
Yes, we're talking about it. Yeah.
Right. This is one item agenda.
Criticism was made by the Secretary of State of other authorities in speeches in various places over time, who was critical of them, the implication being they fiddle their fingers somehow. Yeah. Seems to me that the fork in the road is round about us June, July, where a decision was taken that we had to do far more detailed work in justifying what might be released with the Green Bill or not. The clarification being we're all asked, or members were asked, if they had any comments on it, and I certainly submitted comments about agricultural land and its value. However, it's clear that we were devising a framework to enable sites to be scored. It seems to me the turning point is around about that time, last June, July, and we should explain to the Secretary of State clearly why that decision was taken and why it was necessary.
Okay, so the point of recommendations. The recommendations is that the report is noted.
Given what's been said, well, I don't think that would be particularly good enough of it, because we've said about having to look at the process, and we've said about getting the...
Sorry, Jeff, I only said what the recommendation was. I was waiting for this to go.
All right. Good.
Okay.
And you give the recommendation?
Well, the recommendation is that the report is to be noted, but there was all the recommendations that came out, so if people want to comment on exactly what the recommendation was.
That's it. clearly we've asked for a report on the timescale, the original timescale, the comparison to the actual timescale, and why slippage occurred, and the reasons, as much as David can comment, as to when and where and why the slippage occurred. I mean, that's certainly one recommendation that needs to go on.
And I know that when Christina first suggested that, it was suggested an email out from that comeback if we're going to have as a report to the future scrutiny committee.
Yeah.
Are we in agreement with that?
Yeah. Yeah. I have a copy of the Leader of the Council's letter to the Secretary of State detailing the specific special reason for non-compliance.
Could I also recommend that it's a standing item on all our agendas from now on, so we can't let it slip.
Okay. Can we ask if there's a better way of dealing these things rather than going back? If it's a council side decision, there's a better opportunity to engage the wider council rather than having to come through the cabinet before we're basically asked to rubber stamp or otherwise action.
Could you the process?
Yeah.
I could make a comment on that, but we may need to look at it further.
I was
going to
say that
generally speaking, the development planning policy is a cabinet and executive function, and but the determination of the planning policy is a council function, which is why it would normally go to cabinet while it's in the stage of development, and then to council for the final determination. Now, whether or not as part of the executive function, scrutiny committee could have an input into that, but my initial observation might be that may actually add to the timescale, that it has to be part.
We'll have to be going sometimes back to the timescale, wouldn't it?
My suggestion is it might have actually been quicker. If we had to build into the timescale to come to scrutiny committee as well as cabinet, that may affect the timescale, but it's something that we can certainly do.
I think so. I think bringing in for pre-decision scrutiny is certainly something that we should be doing.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think that we can decide the executive decision at all. So the recommendation is that the report be noted that the a report to be brought to the future committee detailing
for the next committee.
I think it has to be until it's done, clear, and
okay. Yeah, an ongoing. Yeah.
Well, I think it has to be a standing item on every scrutiny, one of our scrutiny committees to ensure that it's actually going through as well.
So, a standing item for an update.
Yeah.
The report from the officer with regards to the timescales to a future committee.
That's the one I want, the next committee.
Yeah, I think how are you going to get that?
I think
what we're saying is that the report be noted, that the assistant director reports to the next committee with the detailed timetable and the reasons, and that this matter be a standing item on future agendas of this committee.
From 2003.
This is going to be a very big item. We've got to work. So we're going to have to. I don't want anybody moaning the next committee when we sell you.
Well, there is a vote item.
It is absolutely, It is absolutely. I don't want anybody moaning when we're still here at 12 o'clock.
I'll bring the voting.
The report be noted. That seems quite passive. Personally, I'm incredibly disappointed that we've gone through 13 years and we've actually got this letter. I think that's something we as a council actually should be ashamed of, as opposed to just noting. It's like saying, oh yeah, we used to make it fairness, so we'll just note it. Do you know what I mean? It seems to me, to have that level of intervention, it's not something we should just shrug our shoulders and note, and okay, it's 5:20, let's go. It's something we should be ashamed and embarrassed about, frankly.
I think what we're saying is that we know where it suddenly started to falter, and therefore we're questioning that we fail to meet the deadline set out in that timetable. Until we know exactly that we did fail to meet the deadlines, it could be just be one deadline, it implies all of them. Mm. Until we know that, we can't make any judgments, can we?
Can I try and move this on then? So, can I suggest that we note the report the committee has serious concerns
that
this
is bringing taken so long and is still out of date?
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got an officer's report and we're going to put as a standard item for an update of future committees.
So,
okay.
The person was named, who's that person?
I think we've got some. So we're those three recommendations.
Thank you.